I'm not sure if you're even human if you're not excited by a new Guillermo del Toro film. He's truly one of the most visually stunning directors of our age, matched only by his creativity in myth crafting. If there's anyone who is the filmmaking equivalent to Aesop and his fables, it's Guillermo. A weaver of fantastical realms and gripping myths that deal in a stunning magical realism. And hell, even if you don't like his films, which I personally don't get, but you do you, you should be excited just for the fact that Guillermo is happy. Look at this man, he's a ray of light! His smile could light the sun for millennia! He is the teddy bear of the film world! So yeah, when I found out this was coming out a month ago, I was ecstatic. Admittedly, I was confused that this was the first time I was hearing about it, but we'll get to that. I counted down the days and saw it that Friday night it came out. And while I wouldn't call it Guillermo's best work, not the best from him is better than many directors' wildest dreams. Based on a sleazy noir thriller novel from the 40s, the film perfectly captures that dingy, cheap dime store thriller vibe. Feels gross and harsh, but also with the exaggeration and knowing intrigue that should come with such a property. It's a film you feel first in a way. It's almost a tone piece in just how focused it is on transporting you to that emotional headspace. And yet it's all done with the panache and grace of an old Hollywood film, using the same amazing bag of tricks that captured the similar beauty in Shape of Water, with a few new ones up his sleeve as well. Say what you will about Guillermo, I feel like you could never compare him directly to any of his peers. No one shoots a film like he does. I feel like he innovates every film he shoots, managing to make small moments feel large and large moments feel small in ways that feel incredibly appropriate. All with how the camera moves or frames its subject in ways rarely seen by anyone else. And the ensemble here is great. First things first, Willem Dafoe fucking ate this shit. How did we wait so long to cast him as a shady carnival barker? That's like the perfect role for him! Cate Blanchett is a brilliant femme fatale who can clearly control a room and knows it. Toni Collette, David Strathairn, Richard Jenkins all kill it. Really, there are only two mildly weak spots, Rooney Mara and Bradley Cooper. Neither are bad, but Rooney Mara admittedly has very little to shine with because her character is kind of a nothing burger. She's the angel in a world of devils, but there's little else to her. Mara does what she can, but as a result of her character, she doesn't stand as high as the rest. And Cooper, listen, I'm not a Cooper hater at all, but he's rarely a standout to me. And that's kinda how he is here. He gets the job done and doesn't flash. He's average. He's enough to make this character work, but not leave much of an impression on his own. And in a cast of actors who did, that limits my praise for him. The story is a suitably grimy tale. Admittedly, it's kind of predictable. After seeing a specific scene, I could literally figure out the end from there. But that didn't make it any less impactful. This is a case where predictable doesn't mean boring, but instead means satisfying. Because you get into the story here with a certain level of awareness. It's interesting, but you know the tropes because the film celebrates them. As I said, Guillermo is like Aesop, and does knowing the end of a fable ruin it? Or is the point not the ending, but the journey that makes it hit so much harder? As such, I would hesitate to call this a brilliant masterwork of story by any stretch, but it was a fun romp through back alleys and carnivals and manipulation. That's kind of what a good noir needs to be, and it passed that with flying colors. That said, it's not all roses here. For example, the length. This movie is 2.5 hours, and dear lord does it feel every bit of that length. I felt exhausted by the end, and it's certainly not helped by the fact that, at times, it feels like two different movies. They're both great movies, but I don't feel they're perfectly incorporated, so the disconnect does peek out a few times. Really, this film was a treat, though. In a way, I view it as a midpoint between Shape of Water and Crimson Peak. Like, it doesn't fall into pure stylish as much as Peak, but it never reaches the emotional gut punches as Shape. Or Pan, for that matter, but Pan is a whole different category. But really, if you're into Del Toro, this is a really good to great Del Toro film. And he's absolutely made less good films than this. As I mentioned, Crimson Peak is good, but doesn't reach this level. So I have no hesitancy in recommending you see it. If you even can, that is. Yeah, so I mentioned I only just knew this was coming out a month prior, and that should have been sign enough of what I'd find out later. See, Nightmare Alley was acquired as part of Searchlight when Disney bought Fox. It was already contractually obligated, so Disney released it on the same weekend as Spider-Man. Now, Spider-Man is technically still Sony, but Disney gets 25% cut, and supporting it will boost their own Marvel properties, so Disney was gonna gain the most from that. So when I say I think Disney was purposefully trying to hurt Nightmare Alley's profitability, I mean it. Fuck, my last video was on The French Dispatch, a Searchlight film that also barely got a push and was left out to dry. I genuinely wonder if Disney is purposely bombing Searchlight films so they can shut it down and reallocate resources to their moneymakers. People are already reporting theaters canceling screenings of this film to play Spider-Man in more theaters, and it just depresses me because this is a great film that people aren't going to see because of studio politics, but goddammit, it deserves its chance. Give Nightmare Alley a shot, please, before they put it to pasture far too early. Guillermo del Toro's Nightmare Alley gets an 8 out of 10.